So we can finally now construct the canonical or more examples of canonical manifolds, and some of the arguments will be a bit sketchy because I will rather provide a sketch of how to construct these canonical manifolds and to motivate this. And if you're really interested in the nitty-gritty details, there are more details in the lecture notes and also some references to literature where this is actually done, because some of the pieces you need to check for this construction of canonical manifolds, they are a bit technical and go a bit beyond what I want to describe. However, the main upshot here will be that the smooth functions from a compact manifold with values in possibly an infinite dimensional manifold, they form a canonical manifold if the target manifold has a local addition. Okay, and let's look at our general assumptions. So we will always assume that in this section, K is a compact manifold, M a manifold with local addition. The local addition will always be called sigma. And we will assume that the theta, again, this mapping which records the base point and then applies the local addition in the second component, is a diffeomorphism onto some open neighborhood of the diagonal. And as a rule of thumb, all function spaces we encounter will be endowed with a compact open C-infinity topology. Okay. So we've already seen in the last section on vector bundles and so forth that the C-infinity function sitting over a smooth function from K to M, they form a locally convex space. And we are taking here the smooth functions with values in the tangent bundle, right? So we use the tangent bundle as the vector bundle we want to talk about, because our local addition is defined on a subset of the tangent bundle, okay? And so we have already this locally convex vector space structure. Then what you can prove, or if you believe me that this new locally convex vector space structure is actually the same or topologically the same as a subspace topology induced by the compact open C infinity topology, then what you can work out using the definitions is that the set OF, where you take the C infinity functions into TM sitting over F, intersected with the C infinity functions which take K into this open subset U. This is open in the space of C infinity functions over F. And so the U here is the domain of definition of our local addition sigma, right? So we OF are all the functions sitting over F which lie in the domain of the local addition. Okay. And then another thing which you have to prove, but this works a lot like other arguments we have seen with the compact open or the compact open C infinity topology, the set OF prime, those are now all the smooth functions from K with values in M, such that if I take F and G and apply them to K, so that I look at the image of these functions, this image should lie in U prime. And remember, U prime is in M times M, so in the product manifold. So this is in M times M. So this actually makes sense. So we are basically asking that all elements of this form, so F of X and G of X, so these things should be inside of the U prime. And the meaning of this is, or the upshot of what this condition means is, so we want that F of X and G of X, they are close to the diagonal. Remember that U prime is an open neighborhood of the diagonal in the Cartesian product here. So what we want is that the two functions map their points near the diagonal. And what we mean by near, so near is this set U prime. It's near to the diagonal if it's inside of the U prime or inside of the points which can be reached using the local addition, right? And so This is not hard to see that the OOF prime is also an open subset of the C infinity functions. And we use all of this data to define now a canonical chart around F. And these things are usually, because you can also have other charts, these are called canonical charts around a smooth function in this soon to be manifold of functions. Okay, and what we can do is, if we have an F, then it's well defined to define a map, or it makes sense to define a mapping from OF to OF prime. And what's happening here, we are sending a smooth function over F to the composition of the smooth function with the local addition. Let's just go back once and check that this really makes sense. So OF was defined as all the functions sitting over F such that they map all of K into U. U was the domain of definition of the local addition. So actually, everything which lies in OF can be composed with the local addition. Okay. And so what we, and the OF prime, those are all the mappings G, such that if I look at the pair F, G, of K, I land in U prime, which is, so U prime is given as, since the theta here is a diffeomorphism, so this is the image of U under theta. Okay, and what happens now if we look at this, so our mapping is now sigma composed with X, and so we have to write, let's see, sigma composed with X, yes. And to understand what is going on, let us use the following. Let's take pi, and let's look at this guy. So what do we get? So we actually, at a point, let's say K or something like that. So we actually get, since X is a mapping sitting over F, for the first component, we get F of X. Second component will then be sigma composed with X of K. Right? And this thing here is an element by construction in U prime. Remember, this is theta, and U prime is theta of U. Right? So this, it makes actually sense and defines a mapping from the open set OF, taking values in the open set OF prime. Okay. So fair enough. So, and what I want is that these guys here become parametrizations or charts. Okay, and now I'm skipping over some tedious details here, but what you can prove using our usual results on the compact open C infinity topology. So it turns out that this mapping is a homeomorphism, and the inverse of this mapping is just given by, you take theta inverse, we can do this because we require theta to be a diffeomorphism, and compose it with F, G. And so the phi F is then called a canonical chart for our mapping F, right? So that this actually is an inverse is a quick computation. It's basically working similar to what we had before. So the computation on the last slide, let's just go back, because this is theta of X. And so you see, we get basically this, when we rewrite the second component, so this is F of X. And the second component, we have then phi F of X, and then evaluated at K. Sorry, it was K. All of these things here are K. Okay. So we see if we take phi f of x and insert it into this formula as the g, we see that we exactly, when we apply a theta inverse, we get back the x we started with. Okay, so this is homeomorphism with inverse. And obviously, since we want a smooth manifold structure, we now need to show that the change of charts are smooth. And we need to verify this now, that the canonical charts form a smooth atlas. So we need to study these change of charts, phi h inverse composed with phi f. Okay, and first of all, since we already know that the phi f are homeomorphisms, we know that this mapping is defined on an open subset of the smooth mappings over H, right? So this is just the homeomorphism property. And now for smoothness, we use the exponential law. And how this works out, so due to the exponential law, it suffices to check instead of the smoothness of this guy, it's enough to check whether the mapping, which sends tau and x to phi inverse composed with phi of tau and then evaluated in x, is smooth. However, we can rewrite this as theta inverse, that's a smooth map, in h and the sigma of tau. So sigma is a smooth map. We also required this with the composition. And we have evaluated everything here in x. So the tau is a smooth map. So this is tau in x. This tau is smooth in x. And composing it with the sigma in this way, it also gets smooth. Actually, when you really want to check that this is true, I'm cheating here. I mean, so the formula on the right-hand side implies or shows that if the exponential law holds, that the change of charts is smooth. Why am I phrasing it like this? So we are working on an open subset of this space here, of the C infinity function sitting over H. Now, the trick is that these C infinity functions were topologized by going into this product of C infinity functions UI, let's say F. And what you need to do, and this is sort of the details I'm swallowing here. We have the exponential law only for spaces of this type. So for the pieces of the product, we don't know yet the exponential law for a space of this type. And I'm insinuating here that this also holds. I mean, the proof that you get an exponential law type result is not hard. You basically have to go into the onto the right-hand side, into the orange boxes, and have to argue that smoothness with respect to these orange boxes implies smoothness with respect to the structure in the yellow box. However, this requires again some localization arguments and to work out through all the identifications and so forth. It's not hard to do. The upshot of it is that there an exponential law holds for the smooth functions over these over the H, and this is a possibility to check that the change of charts we have here, so of these canonical charts, are actually smooth. And this is then given by the formula here, which turns out to be smooth in tau and x, right? Okay. However, we are sort of sweeping these details a little bit under the rug. The point is here we have this exponential law on the pieces and we can exploit it, and in the end it works out. This idea was first promoted by Peter Michor to use the exponential law to this end. The more traditional proof uses something called the Omega lemma. So I'm not going to talk about the Omega lemma. This is some additional information you find in the older literature, the proof which doesn't exploit the exponential law for these kinds of construction, but the so-called Omega lemma for composition of smooth mappings with sections. Okay. Anyway, the upshot is that the C infinity functions from K to M with these canonical charts, they actually form a smooth infinite dimensional manifold modeled on these spaces of sections. Okay, now we have a smooth manifold structure. The underlying topology is the compact open C infinity topology. And so what is left to do is we have to show that this manifold structure we have just constructed using these canonical charts is actually a canonical manifold structure in the sense that we discussed in the lecture. So the underlying topology needs to be the compact open C infinity topology. Well, this is fine. We just required this to be the topology. However, we need to prove that the exponential law is true. Okay, and let's see how the proof works. Okay, so basically, the next proposition I want to prove is that the manifold structure on the C infinity functions is canonical. And this will also imply the following: because canonical manifold structures are unique, the manifold structure in the construction on the last slide, it may depend on the choice of local addition. And since this proposition will show that the manifold structure is canonical, the nice part about this proof is that it also directly shows that our construction was independent of choice of local addition. So, canonical manifold structures are unique up to diffeomorphism. Okay, now let's see how the proof works. And so the first step we are taking is the evaluation mapping is smooth. And so again, I just give a sketch here. So on one hand, I need another color. So, it suffices to prove smoothness, locally, in charts. Thus, this is a question about the evaluation on these spaces C infinity F K T M, right? Because they are the model spaces on which we are building stuff. And again, we can resolve these spaces as a product, the C infinity functions, and I'm not writing this out. And for the spaces on the right-hand side, so for the green ones here, we already know that the evaluation mapping is smooth. And so I'm cheating here. So this is why this is only a sketch, lacking the details. So what you have to do in this step, and again, it's more of a tedious rewriting exercise, but one has to do it. So the evaluation mapping is smooth because we can check smoothness in charts. And for the charts, this becomes basically a question about the evaluation mapping here in the green box. And for this one, we already know that it's smooth. Okay. So basically, this concludes the first step with a lot of hand waving. I have not shown you any of the details. I'm just appealing to the intuition that all of these questions about the evaluation map can be relegated to the smoothness of an evaluation map, which we already know. Okay, right. So once we have the smoothness of the evaluation map, this already shows the following. Actually, it's not really a step, but if we have a smooth mapping into the smooth mappings, then the associated map F wedge is also smooth. And why is that? Because the F wedge can be written as the evaluation map composed with our mapping F. And then we have to take the identity on, sorry, not L. Oh, yes, that should be, sorry, the identity on K I need to take here. This is, should be the identity on K, right? And this is smooth. This guy is smooth by step one. So this guy is smooth. And this is the easy half of the exponential law. If we all, or once one already knows that the evaluation map is smooth. I mean, step one is not easy, but step two is then easy because we have this nice identity for the F wedge in terms of the F, which we already know is smooth, and the identity on K. Okay. Anyway, so we're coming to the final step. So we now want the converse. So let's assume we have a smooth map on the Cartesian product. And we want to prove smoothness of the associated map of the FV into the C infinity functions. This will complete our proof that the exponential law is true for these kinds of spaces. So we have one half of the exponential law already. So if we have a smooth mapping into the our manifolds of mappings, then the associated map is smooth. However, we also need to show that we can go back, and this will not only show that the mapping F is smooth if and only if the F wedge is smooth, but also that we have this nice identity of the spaces. So C infinity from L to C infinity KM is then bijective correspondence with C infinity L times K and values in M, right? So this is sort of the space version of the exponential law we want to prove. Okay, for this last step, let's switch to the e-paper again. And let's see how we are doing this. Okay. So we started now with a mapping. Let me just check how did I call this one? Ah, yeah. So let's assume that so let's assume we have a mapping H from L times K with values in M, which is smooth. Okay. So on one hand, what do we know? So I need to look at my annotation here. All right. So we have the H here. And what we want to see is the HV going from L into the C infinity functions from K to M. This should be smooth. So let's note first. That HV makes sense as HV of X. This is by definition H of X, and I shouldn't use a semicolon here. So then we have the dot here. Okay, so this is a smooth function from K to M. Okay. Okay, so we have this, and since the topology on C infinity KM is the compact open C infinity topology, we already know that HV need to phrase this differently. We don't know that the HV is continuous as a compact, which is finer than the compact open topology. Okay, however, we know that HV is continuous as a mapping into the space of continuous functions from K to M with the compact open topology. So this was proved in the section on the compact open topology. If we have a continuous mapping on the product and then take the HV, then the HV is continuous as a mapping into the space of continuous functions. And here we would have something which is even stronger. However, the HV is a continuous mapping. Okay. Now, let F, let's define a mapping F, so an auxiliary mapping, and let's say this is HV of X. So we're fixing for some fixed X in L. Okay. So let's define another mapping, psi f takes continuous functions from k with values in m and takes it to the Cartesian product from k, continuous functions from k to m with itself, or I could also write continuous functions from k values in m times m. And what it does, so it takes a continuous function and sends it to G and then F. So this is continuous. And why do we want this continuous mapping? So what we want is we want to describe set W. This should be the pre-image of this mapping OF prime. Yeah, so the set OF prime. What was that again? Let's just recall. So we have this canonical chart around the F, which maps OF to OF prime, and the OF prime, those were all the G in the C infinity functions from K to M, such that f of x, g of x lies inside the u prime. Okay, and okay, and the reason why I wanted this, so if we compute what is the inverse image under this h, of the OF prime, then it turns out that I can write this as psi f composed with h v, take the inverse of all the functions mapping k into u prime. Now this just comes from this identity below here. I took the wrong way around, so I need to put the f here in the first component, f and g. So now this works out with this definition. Okay. So the upshot, why did we want this? So this is an open neighborhood. In L, an open X neighborhood in L, right? So this was where we chose the X. Okay, so let's take a look. So what happens if I take the canonical chart, or the inverse of the canonical chart rather, and compose this with HV, and I restrict the HV to this neighborhood W. So from the signature of this, this is something which goes from W into, well, if I take the HV first, then we are ending up in the OF prime. And the OF prime, so I'm taking this, the phi F inverse, this is going to OF. Okay. And let's take the wedge of such a map. So this is sitting inside of the C infinity functions, f over f from k to tm. So I want to take the wedge of this. So while the thing in the bracket is something which eats just one argument, if I take the wedge, it eats again two arguments. And now crawling through the definitions, and I really recommend this to see what's going on. So this is, I take the HV of Y of the first one. Then I have put here the F and theta inverse, composed with these guys, and then I evaluate in Z. Okay, why is that? So all of this stuff, what I have here, is just the definition of the phi F inverse. Well, and then the rest of this insertion scheme, so this guy here is just coming from the HV. This eats one thing. And in the end, I get a function which eats another argument. So the z is then inverted later. Or in other words, I can write this as theta inverse f of z h, the original h of y and z. This is just from the definitions. And this is smooth. Okay. And why did we want to do this? We can now apply the exponential law. to see that also, sorry, phi f inverse composed with h v restricted to w is smooth, right? So we have here that the mapping of two variables is smooth, and we are in a situation where we can again apply the exponential law. So the actual argument would require you to again, so this takes values in the C infinity function sitting over f from k to tm. Again, to get on the nose the statement we called in the lecture, the exponential law, and to apply this, you would have again to resolve this in this product and to argue with the exponential law on the spaces on the right hand side. Okay, so this would actually be then on the nose using the statement of the exponential law as we had it in the lecture, since we didn't prove the exponential law yet for the spaces of smooth mapping sitting over f. However, we are not doing this detail again. I mean, you see, it's always the same argument with these spaces of mapping sitting over f. We're always pushing them into this direct product on the right-hand side and then apply the things we already know about the pieces of the direct product on the right-hand side. Okay. So, however, this concludes the proof. So we have now, I mean, perhaps what we can, of course, note is the upshot of step 2 and 3 is the following. So f from some manifold L with values in the smooth function k to m is smooth if and only if the associated map f wedge from L times k with values in m is smooth. And this is the exponential law for the space, or for the manifold C infinity k. And this was the ingredient we really wanted to prove, to see that it's a canonical manifold. Okay. Anyway, so let's get back to the slides. So there is one last thing which I wanted to show you before we are done for today, and this is an important consequence of our construction of the manifold of mappings using this local addition. And again, I will only show you the result and perhaps try to explain a little bit why this is plausible, while we will not go through the proof, which is again technical, and we don't have, I don't want to spend too much time on this. However, so we have now our canonical charts and built a nice manifolds of mappings. And using a local addition, this will allow us to identify the tangent bundle of this manifold of mapping. And recall, so if we have a vector in the C infinity Km is now a smooth manifold, right? So we can construct a tangent bundle abstractly, and by just saying, okay, we look at equivalence classes of smooth curves. So a smooth curve lives now on some open subset around zero, say, and takes values in the C infinity functions. And since we know already that our manifold structure is canonical, we can now exploit the exponential law to identify the tangent bundle. I mean, we've just seen the C is smooth if and only if the C wedge now from minus epsilon epsilon times K with values in M is smooth. And basically what this identification says, if you want to take d dt, say at t equal to zero of the C, so this is usually up to the equivalence relation, what we would call V here. This coincides with taking the partial derivative with respect to the time variable, setting t equal to zero, of this mapping C wedge. Right, so we can, so this is what the exponential law gives us. So instead of taking the usual derivative, we can relate the curve C to a mapping of two variables and take the partial derivative to see what is going to happen. If we take the partial derivative, what kind of mapping, I should probably say, corresponds to, yeah, so it's not on the nose, the same one. So what do we get here on the right-hand side? So after we set time t to zero, we don't, we don't have a time variable anymore. However, we get a mapping which takes elements of k and maps them now to some space. And the space it maps them to is not m. It's Tm, right? Because we've taken the derivative, so whatever we get on the right-hand side will be living in the tangent bundle. And while I'm just glossing over the technical details, what you can prove is, I mean, on one hand, on the level of tangent spaces, we get... if M has a local addition, we get a bijection of the following kind. So you're mapping the tangent space into the smooth mapping sitting over the base point of the tangent space. Recall, so the gamma here, while it's a base point of the tangent space, the gamma is an element in the C infinity functions. So gamma is itself a function. And the identification or this bijection is, so it takes an equivalence class of curves and sends it to the map, which sends a k to the equivalence class of curves t goes to c wedge of tk. So this is exactly what we did in other notation on the slide before, where we said that we're taking the derivative here. So we will see later on some applications of this. However, we get a bijection. And we see that elements in the tangent space of this manifold of mapping are just mappings sitting over the base point with values in the tangent bundle of the original target manifold. Yes. So, and gluing all these things together, we get a bundle isomorphism. So a diffeomorphism on the manifold level, which identifies the tangent bundle of the C infinity functions with the C infinity functions with values in the tangent bundle. So in a way, this whole canonical manifolds of mappings construction, what it does, it gives us a nice way to deal with tangent manifolds, because if we want to compute the tangent of such a manifold of mappings, we can identify it with a manifold of mappings into the tangent manifold. And this is super advantageous for a lot of computations and for a lot of things we want to be doing later on, because here on the left-hand side, we have to deal with curves living on this infinite dimensional manifold. However, in the identification on the right-hand side, we end up again with a manifold of the same type, with one of these manifolds of mappings. The only thing which changed is that the manifold we are mapping into is different. So the tangent functor commutes with taking these manifolds of mappings, right? So we can move the T inside and throw it onto the target. And this is a huge advantage for all of the calculations we want to be doing. So to give you an impression, we have, for example, that the push forward and the pullback maps are smooth. The push forward is just you map G to F composed with G, and pullbacks on the other hand so we are composing just in the other way. And we can now use this identification to compute actually what a nice formula for the tangents of these smooth mappings. So, and let's see if I have TF star, let's say of C, then by definition, this is the same as T goes to F composed with C of T. And using the identification, what I can do is, so this corresponds under our identification to the curve K, sorry, K gets mapped to the equivalence class T gets mapped to F composed with C. Then I take a wedge, then we take T and K. However, when I look at this formula, so the F is just a mapping of one variable, so it takes things in M and so forth. So what I see here, this is K gets mapped to T gets mapped to F composed with the C wedge and TK. Okay, and now we're taking a derivative. And what happens if I'm taking the derivative here? So I'm on one hand, I take the partial derivative of the C wedge. And from the perspective of the F, I'm just taking the usual derivative or the tangent map of the F, since F is a mapping smooth between from the manifold M with values in the manifold N. And what's happening if I take the derivative here? So I can put out the F here from the composition as TF by the chain rule. Or in other words, what this means is if I take the tangent map of the push forward, this is just the push forward with the tangent map of F. And on the other hand, if I take the tangent map of the pullback, I get the pullback, but now living on a different manifold. So the original pullback, the H star, was a pullback from the C infinity function with values in M to the C infinity functions starting in L with values in M. And here we see, if I take the tangent bundle, the tangent map of the pullback, then this is just the pullback, but now with the changed target spaces, right? So I have TM and TL. However, we see that the push forward, if we want to take the derivative of the push forward, this is heaping derivatives on the smooth map F, which is not a problem. So we can derivate the F as often as we want. Whereas for the pullback, such a thing is not happening. So in a way, I mean, we are changing the manifolds on which the pullback is acting because we are putting the T here on the right-hand side on the target. However, we are not taking derivatives of H. So, I mean, in the worst case, I mean, this wouldn't make sense because we have smooth mappings here. So if H was only continuous, say, and not differentiable, at least sort of the formula would be okay, but obviously sort of the pullback mapping would not make sense as a mapping between spaces of smooth maps. So anyway, what I wanted to get at is, of course, I mean, we are always dealing with smooth functions. However, you can construct similar topologies, similar manifold structures for, say, for example, finitely often differentiable mappings, right? So replacing the C infinity here with CK mappings, for example. And then you can study smoothness or continuity of the push forward and the pullback. Both of them are continuous. But in general, say, if you have CK functions here and you pull back with the CK functions, then you only get a continuous mapping because we see that if the mapping is still of class or if F is only a CK mapping, we are losing every time we take a derivative of the push forward. We are losing one order of differentiability of the mapping F. Whereas for the pullback, this is inessential. So the pullback is not heaping derivatives on H, whereas the push forward is doing that. And this is one of the reasons why smooth functions are very nicely behaved, because push forward and pullback both are smooth. If we would go to spaces of finite order differentiability, then the push forward and the pullback would behave differently. So the pullback would still be smooth with respect to the to the spaces of C, to the space of CK mappings, whereas the push forward would only be continuous in general. All right. And this is all I wanted to say about these manifolds of mappings. And we will soon see more applications of what you can actually use this manifold structure for.